I'm Emily Curran. I'm executive director of the Old South Meeting House, and I am delighted to welcome you here tonight to Musical Boston. The Fife is right. This is our 9th annual Old South History Quiz Show. Now I'm very pleased to introduce, first of all, our team of panelists. And they are starting with Catherine David. Yep, we're making sure people sit in the right seat, so tell us if we do it wrong. Catherine is a musician. She's been on the Boston scene for the past 30 years. We are thrilled that she could be with us here tonight. Next is Charlie Bainey. Charles Bainey is a historian, and he's author of The Chronicles of Old Boston and The Complete Guide to Boston's Freedom Trail. Next, we have Carrie Sharon. Or did I say that right? Carrie is a Boston-based singer, songwriter, and assistant professor at Berklee College of Music. And then we have David Coffin, who is returning to be on our teams. He is a performer of traditional and contemporary folk music, and you may also know him as master of ceremonies for revels for many years. Next we have Frederica King. Frederica is an acclaimed pianist. She performs throughout the United States, Europe, and South America as a soloist and collaborative artist. And last but not least, we have Gretchen Greutzer, director of the Jamaica Plain Historical Society. She is also a tour leader for Boston by Foot and for the Boston Public Library. And now I'm delighted to introduce Susan Wilson. Susan is our quizmaster for these past 9 years. She is also a fabulous historian. She's a wonderful photographer, and she knows all about all things Boston. So without further ado, I'm handing it to you.
Cool. And behind me, the indomitable, Dan Moylan on flute. Fife is what I meant. It is a flute, but I meant fife. As many of you know who have been here before, after people get an answer correct or wrong, this will be indicated by Dan, who will play things like this. For example, if they got... Spit in it, Dan. That would be a wrong answer. Okay, and what would be an example of a right answer?
What?
A correct answer. He is. I've lost my hearing several times here, Catherine. It's going to be okay. All right. So, just a few rules. How many of you have been here before? Okay, good, good. How many of you have never been here? It's going to be fun. Ellie, hi, how are you? Okay, let me give some rules. First of all, there is no shouting out. Okay, no matter how smart you are, this is you guys, and this is you guys. No shouting out. We raise our hands if we want to, you know, be able to give the answer. Now, this is how it's going to work. We're going to flip a coin. A representative, can someone tell me what the names of the teams are? Because the lovely Ilse Allen, can we have a round of applause for Ilse? Who's a member of the Old South staff and looks indeed lovely tonight. We're all in black, you know, for rock and roll, right? Yeah, okay. All right, so she's going to write down the names of the teams. They have decided their names themselves. So can you tell Ilse what your name is?
We will be known as the Trimount Tones.
The trimount tones. It's not what you think it is.
Oh, it might be.
Oh, it might be what you think it is.
Why, what were you thinking?
I really nothing at all, but it beats what you were talking about before. Okay, and this team is called?
We are the Broken Records.
The Broken Records. When I was downstairs, you guys were the G-strings. What happened? Okay, all right.
They changed.
Oh, Charlie didn't like it, I'm sure. Okay. No, you did like it. We're not even going there. Okay. All right, so what's going to happen is each one of these teams is going to pick a representative. They're going to meet me down front. We're going to flip a coin, and whoever gets heads is going to take the first question. The way this works is, let's say, for example, the Broken Records one. What we're going to do is project a question up there. This is one of the cases where your wheels are turning, but you're not shouting out. They're going to talk to each other, decide if they know the answer. If they know the answer, they will have a spokesperson there say the answer into the microphone. If it's correct, they will get 2 points. Okay? There are other questions you get 1 point for, but these major ones are 2 points. If they start talking and discover they have no idea, that's when, if you know, you raise your hand. You got that obscure one. You got the one about the woman who mans the lighthouse. I remember that. That, and nobody else knew that.
Right.
There's always some person that knows something. I remember. Do you remember that? Because you got it wrong, David, right? Okay.
No, I didn't.
No.
You, the other team.
Right, I knew that. Okay. Anyway, so if they don't know it, you raise your hand if you know it, and they will get the point if you have the correct answer. If you give them the incorrect answer, they will meet you outside afterwards and beat the... Okay. Now, if you guys blow it all together, either here or with the lifeline, then it bumps to the other team, and they get to answer it, okay? We have never in the history of this game not gotten an answer with a combination of our illustrious panelists and you guys out there. Okay?
As long as you're here, we should be fine.
Yeah, because I can answer everything. Yeah. Okay, good.
Well then.
All right. Anyway, so we will keep doing that. Now, that accounts for 20 questions in the course of the evening. The nice thing about this, if you read my little rant in the Globe last week, we don't consider this trivia because we don't just leave you there. It's like, that's the answer, bye, let's go on. We have a little story time after that. And either the person who got the answer or you or whoever will tell you a little story, will show you some illustrations, so you will go out not only amused and nourished, but also smart. Okay? All right, so that's the basic thing. Now, twice in the course of this, halfway through and at the end, we're going to have a lightning round where these guys can pick up points really, really fast. Halfway through, we're going to have a Name That Tune lightning round where Ilse and I are going to exchange places, and she's going to play a portion of a song, and then whoever thinks of it first and thinks they know it, raise your hand. You're not consulting or anything. I'm going to be standing there to see whose hand goes up first. And you get 1 point each for the person and the song. Okay? And again, I'll tell you about the lifelines when we get there, but we can have a lifeline for the second half of the question if they know one part and not the other. So that's midway, and then at the end, we're also going to have a lightning round where we're going to show pictures of individuals, and this is about people who went to local colleges, and that will be an image of them, and you get 1 point each for the name of the individual who went to school in the Boston area, and another point for the school. Okay?
What's that section called again?
That section is called College Girls Gone Wild. Okay? Okay, because we're sophisticated. Okay, is there any question before we get started? You guys cool? Yes. I have to get, you can't? Okay, so guys, when you're talking, get into that microphone. That isn't like too much? Oh, okay. All right, so could I have a captain or representative of each team come down and meet me for the coin toss?
It's easier to get down. Well, okay.
Jump!
Fine. Where's David? Where's David? Where's David? Where's David? David, you could have been. Could you flip? I'm sure we're flipping. Okay. This, the coin, we always have a coin that's somehow applicable to the topic of the evening. This is a 1900 silver dollar. Raise your hand if you know what institution related to music.
Oh, we got one.
That's not the right question.
Yes?
Boston Symphony Hall.
Symphony Hall.
Do they get a point?
Yes. No, they don't. No, yes. They don't. No, they don't, because I told him the answer downstairs.
Well, I guess you shouldn't have.
That's still. I'm going to cash it and put it on the list.
Heads.
If I can.
Oh, we both call it.
What do you call it?
Heads.
Tail.
There you go.
All right.
Okay. So,
what that means? Give my dollar back, David. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So the Baroque records are going to start. Again, don't shout out. Here we go.
You don't raise your hand.
You don't raise your hand. You talk. Okay. Here we go.
I know.
In 1770, Paul Revere made engravings for the first book by the popular teacher and writer William Billings. Billings even taught some of his classes at the Old South. What subject did Billings teach?
Music, but it's probably
does it have to be more specific?
Question.
Do we want to go with it?
It has to be more specific. Like harmony.
Does it mean a lifeline?
I guess we can move the lifeline, right? Have we already said the answer?
No, you haven't said anything out loud. You want to go for our...
You heard us say the answer line. Among ourselves.
I haven't been listening.
She's not allowed to comment.
are you all asking for a lifeline?
Yes, we are.
Would you like to do that?
Well,
yes.
We don't get any points deducted for using it, right?
No, you don't.
Yeah, right.
But could you ask?
Can we have a lifeline, please? Does anybody know the answer?
Look at that eager beaker.
Can we just say yes?
Do we pick the woman?
You pick somebody.
The woman in the red
dress. Only one that raised her hand. It has to be more specific.
William Billings. William Billings taught choral music.
Woo-hoo! Okay, I would have accepted singing as well. Here's a photo I took of Billings at the Old South. He was actually, he was mega famous. This guy was a composer. He wrote all the pop songs of the era. Now consider, this is during the American Revolution, so the pop songs were psalms, hymns, you know, maybe a little ode here and there. Okay, major composer, but how he made his living was as an itinerant singing teacher, and that's him singing, teaching dogs to sing and things like that. And he was good buddies with all the radicals. That wasn't supposed to go in that direction. He was good buddies with all the radicals, and that was the plate that Paul Revere, because Paul had many, many crafts, and that was the plate for one of his most popular books of Psalms, and that as well. So Revere was doing that, but anyway, so William Billings, and you should have gotten that one, because that one was in the Globe. They like said,
thank
William
you.
You read the Globe,
you.
Yeah. All right then. Okay, the Trimount Tunes. Are you ready?
Tones.
Yeah, that too. Okay. All right, here we go. You ready? Okay, let's advance.
The plate that Paul Revere made for William.
I was told this was going to be ornery. Okay. Which of the following meeting houses or churches does not have a Revere bell? The Old North Church, the Old South Meeting House, King's Chapel, or First Church in Roxbury?
It's Old North.
Don't talk to me.
Yes, it's Old North Church.
Old North Church, you're saying? The place where Paul Revere, like, lived?
That's correct. It's
and
a
used to play
Peel.
The bells and stuff like that? You're saying
it's
they
a,
didn't have a Revere
a
bell?
Peel and they
you're
were cast
right. Okay, so indeed it's true. It seems ironic since he's so associated with the North End. Man! It's William Billings. Come on. Okay, Old North Church is the one that doesn't have a Revere bell. Here's Revere in the famous Copley painting. Now, how many of you have seen me desecrate this before? You see me desecrate this? Okay. I love to play with this because I'm a Photoshop freak. So here he is making a bell. Okay. Now, for anyone who's been here before, we've used this picture and desecrated it prior. For example, we have him with his pot, with the bell, with a Mary Jane, and with a skull. And it just depends on what year you come. Okay. It's a fine job, isn't it? Okay. Anyway, so here he was with his bell again. Damn you. Okay, come on. Okay.
Okay. I've seen that.
I know that. Trust me, I know that. Okay, have you seen this? Okay. And here, by the way, is the one that was installed here 2 years ago, October.
Sang at the installation.
You sang at the, oh yeah, Carrie is, among other things, she is a featured soloist, mezzo, in the Old South Choir. Members of the Old South Church? Members of the Old South Church? Oh, great. Okay.
I tried.
You tried, you know. Okay, anyway, here's First Church in Roxbury. Now, why would they have one? Who cares about a First Church in Roxbury? What's that got to do with Revere and the Revolution? Ah, come on.
He made a lot of bells.
It's founded by John Eliot, right, where William Dawes started on his ride. Joseph Warren went there. Big, big, big in historic everything. And here's the
King's Chapel.
David wants to show a sweatshirt from the Roxbury Latin School where Joseph Warren went. Okay, good. All right. Here's King's Chapel. This was taken a couple of days ago up the street. And King's Chapel, by the way, not only have a Revere bell, this is the bell that actually rang when Revere died because he was buried at the granary, and so they played one of his bells for his own funeral, so that's kind of wonderfully strange. Does anyone know what else King's Chapel has to do with music history?
Daniel Pinkham. They were the first...
Daniel Pinkham? Okay, yes.
They were the first church to have an organ, I believe.
First one, the permanent organ. Yep. Anything else?
They had the first music festival in the 1700s or something.
They actually, they had the first performance of Handel's Messiah was there.
Yes.
And 18, another group formed
1818,
there.
Handel and Haydn.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Woo! Okay. I'd love to give you extra points, but I'm not going to.
Got more?
Absolutely. There's always
yes,
more.
Charlie?
But Paul Revere rang the bell at Old North. That's why he couldn't make it, because he was only 15 years old.
Right, and he was too busy ringing the bell. Right, okay. Okay, anyway, so I'd love to make this go forward, but you know that I've failed at this many times before. Okay. Really, really trying, guys. Okay, Old South. This is when, during the ceremonies many of you came to at the Old South 2.5 years ago, when, and that's Carrie in the upper left, right, where near that yellow jacket. That's where she was sitting. I know, I have a picture of you. Okay, and we're going to be here till 9:30 if this thing doesn't, okay. And this is the news media ooing and aahing over the bell. And there it is being lifted up and brought into the tower. So it was a pretty amazing event. Okay. You ready, Baroque?
Yeah.
During the Civil War, Julia Ward Howe borrowed a marching tune called John Brown's Body and used it for her song, Battle Hymn of the Republic. Where in Boston was John Brown's Body originally written and sung?
We have to go for a lifeline on that one.
I mean,
that's okay.
Who are you? Who are you?
Who are you selecting?
You want Nancy?
The lighthouse.
No, it's not at the lighthouse. It was at Fort Warren on George's Island.
Nice. Anyway, indeed, out in the harbor, George's Island, Fort Warren, was built during the Civil War, and there were a bunch of soldiers out there. Actually, they kept on building it through most of the Civil War. They didn't even finish it during the Civil War, but Union soldiers were out there. They also kept a bunch of Confederate prisoners there. But while they were digging and doing things, allegedly, they took an old camp song. Here's some of the guys.
And they started singing John Brown's Body. And they were singing it later on, okay, and there's the marching song. It became the marching song of Union troops during the Civil War. And even though Julia Ward Howe lived here, it was when she was down in Washington and there were Union troops from Massachusetts marching down there that she heard them, and she had her carriage chase after them so she could get the song, and then she stole it. And there's Julia. She felt really bad and aged quickly. I'm sorry. And this is down in the Back Bay. See? Author, editor, preacher, and battle hymn. So she got a lot of credit for that. And by the way, she first printed that in the Atlantic Monthly in 1862. And apparently, Abraham Lincoln, when he read it, cried. And the Atlantic Monthly paid her $5. Okay, so there you go. Okay, you ready, guys? Trimount? Mary Sawyer of Sterling, Massachusetts, donated small segments of yarn pinned to autograph note cards as part of the effort to save the Old South Meeting House from destruction in the decade following the Great Fire of 1872. What was Mary's claim to fame? That is, why would anyone want to buy her autographed yarn cards? If this isn't esoteric, I don't know what is. Yes.
Well, since you've already used Fort Warren on George's Island, which is what we were going to say, I think we're going to go for a lifeline. Who's going to... Oh, look at all the hands.
Oh, look at all these hands. Yeah,
but you have to look really eager and secure and solid in your... You're waving. You're waving. I'm liking it. We're going to go with you. Tell me your name.
Well, let's let the microphone get there.
Yep, yep.
Okay. Would that be Mary of Mary Had a Little Lamb fame?
You were right. You had it.
So, little Mary Sawyer, okay? Allegedly, the story really happened, and, you know, this lamb followed her to school. Well, anyway, here's one of the sample of one of the cards. What she had done was her little lamb, which she sheared periodically, she had pulled some wool off it and made it into socks. But she loved the Old South Meeting House so much that when she was older and someone said, can you contribute something, she disassembled the socks, pulled out little pieces of yarn, put them on these cards, and they sold them for $100 a pop. That's a lot of money. Yeah. So here's a photo I took of Mary. And here is the song. It wasn't until about two decades later that they actually set it to music, but it became immediately very popular. And it was also, for many years, a lot of people said someone else wrote this song. Does anyone know who got credit for it? A very famous woman?
For writing the song?
Yeah. Yeah, Sarah Josepha Hale actually got credit for it because she was the editor, and they didn't have like copyright and stuff back then. So what this is a copy of a plaque out in Sterling that it was about Mary Elizabeth Sawyer. Her teacher, who, you know, put up with the lamb, was Rebecca Kimball. John Rolston was the guy that came by and wrote the poem about it, but Sarah Josepha Hale got all the credit because she added some lyrics and stuff, added some words, and then later published it in her book. And by the way, that's Sarah Josepha Hale. And does anyone know why, in talking about her, I've made this just lovely collage? It's kind of odd.
You thought Lincoln was a jerk?
This woman over here with the wait, just wait till we get the mic there.
She badgered Abraham Lincoln so hard that he eventually established Thanksgiving Day.
Right.
And so you have a turkey, and you have the turkey, Abraham, and you have Sarah, and then she also helped raise the money to complete the Bunker Hill Monument.
Right. Awesome. Mary gets a point. Okay. Oh, that's also Mary. Okay. There's. Okay. All right, guys. We good? All right, so now we're on to the Baroques. Okay, here we go, guys. Oh, okay, sorry. This is where you're all involved. Get out your little signs. Now, this is how this works. Fi or huzzah? Fi is no, huzzah is yes, okay? So what's going to happen is you are going to vote for this team. Okay, so you are going to try to make a decision as to what, if this is true or false. Thomas Edison's original patented phonograph was exhibited at the Old South Meeting House as part of an innovation show in 1876. That is true. That is true. Here's what you're going to vote on in a moment. The first piece that Edison recorded on his talking machine was Mary Had a Little Lamb. All right. If you think this is true, I want you to raise up huzzah. Okay, and who's counting?
We don't have to take that vote, right?
Okay, this many, it looks like the majority of people. Okay, put them down. We may ask you to do it again. How many say fie? This is not true. This is. Okay, clearly the majority of the audience thinks it's true that Mary Had a Little Lamb was again popularized here. Okay, do you guys agree with them or not?
Can we ask them questions?
No, you can't ask them questions.
Are they just saying that because we talked about Mary Had a Little Lamb, or do they really think it's true?
It's true.
I'm abstaining.
You can't abstain, Carrie.
There are three of us.
Okay.
Two of us think it's true.
Two of you are right on. Thank you, audience. Thank you very much. Yay! Round of applause. Okay, here we go. Trimounts?
It's okay. I'm clapping for the audience.
Oh, here's, by the way, there's Mary Had a Little Lamb, and there's Mr. Edison, and here's, this is the actual poster when his little talking machine was being used at the Old South. And this is the popular picture of him with his phonograph. The fact is, when they were at the Old South, it didn't look like that. Looked like that. That's him, okay? And that's what the phonograph looked like at the time, but, you know, 30 years later, they edited it. Okay, yes.
Do you have a picture of him with a bell?
No, but I'm gonna make it up when I go home and send it to you. Okay, all right, as I said, Trimount, here we go.
Trimount.
English immigrant and boat maker Robert Paget invented the famed swan boats in 1877, inspired in part by an opera he had recently heard in New York. What is the name of that opera?
The opera is Lohengrin.
We don't want to think about it.
No.
Lovely. Would you care to explain more about that, Frederica?
I don't know the plot in depth, but it is one of Richard Wagner's famous operas, and I believe that he has gone somewhere inappropriate and is returning on a swan boat.
The Trimounts you're talking about, inappropriate.
Yeah. Yes, and I believe there was a production that the famous tenor Lawrence Melchior starred in, and I believe he died in that production in the Swan Boat, but don't quote me on that.
I keep wanting to give you extra points, but I actually, so in Wagner's Lohengrin, no, I'm not gonna, I just want to, he actually is saving a maiden from in distress, and he goes across a lake drawn across by a swan, and Paget just loved this. And there were two things related when he first invented the swan boats. By the way, that's Robert Paget on the left. His granddaughter sent that to me and said, "Sorry, it's so scary, but it's the only picture we have." It's like, Wagner. And then there's Wagner, who looks a lot more sedate. But those original swan boats, have you never seen the pictures, had a lot smaller capacity than they do today. Okay, so this is back in the late 1870s, where there's not a whole lot of room for anybody. Just a little bit later, where they're up to two rows, so they certainly have grown. And just to mention something, somebody who doesn't get her due, this is his wife. And his wife, he invented them in 1877, but he died in 1878. And so his wife, Julia Paget, took over the business and ran the swan boats for the next 20, 25 years at a time when women didn't run businesses. And she was running it, making money, you know, becoming iconic in town, and you never see her name, although now you do because of the Boston Women's Heritage Trail. You get to see it. But anyway, she did an amazing job. And this is her granddaughter, great-granddaughter, Lynn. That's with Mrs. Menino. And this is a couple of years ago when I was part of a group that helped make a city landmark out of the swan boats. And that's Lynn still running the joint. And this is her whole family with the mayor and everybody else celebrating the swan boats. And what a lot of people don't know is that they think the swan boats is a city-run thing. It's run by the Paget family and has been since the beginning. It's the Paget Enterprise. It's pretty cool. All right, then. Are we ready, Baroques?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, there's my dog.
He's been on a swan boat.
By the swan boats. I like to take pictures of famous... We'll talk about that later. Okay. And, oh...
Shirley Temple.
Because we lost Shirley this year, really big event for anyone who was here in 1935 with me. That Shirley Temple came to town and they practically flooded the entire public garden with people seeing her, but that's her on the swan boats. And so remembering Shirley. Okay.
Awesome.
All right. Are we on to Trimount?
No, Baroques.
I think we're
Baroques.
Oh, the Baroques are up? Okay.
Let them go.
Okay. Oh. Henry Lee Higginson founded the Boston Symphony Orchestra in 1881, but did not build the group its own performance space until two decades later. Where was the BSO's musical home before Higginson had Symphony Hall constructed?
It's what was then known as the Music Hall, which is the site now occupied by the Orpheum Theater.
So you're saying it was called the Music Hall and it's the site of today's Orpheum Theater? That's what you're saying? Well, you're right. Yes. That was the original name of the BSO.
Not quite.
Anyway, that's the place. That was the old Music Hall. Here's, and it looked, you know, if you look at it, it's really very much the same. Okay, the same entrance, the same going down Hamilton Place, whatever. And indeed, lots and lots of things happened there. And so Higginson had them play there and then decided to go way out Huntington and build his new joint. This is interesting. Oh, there's Higginson. He was a Harvard dropout and a Civil War vet, and had a whole lot of money. This is a drawing of what Symphony Hall was supposed to look like. Now, you'll see in the front, above the columns, the Boston Music Hall, because he thought the old Music Hall was going to get torn down. Did it get bright here suddenly?
Yes.
Could someone unbrighten it?
Well, it was a little... dim.
Yeah, but it's better to see the pictures if it's dim. If we could dim those lights, that would be awesome. Yeah, I know. Contradictory. Anyway, so look at all this stuff, okay? So he was going to call it the Boston Music Hall because he thought they were going to tear down the Music Hall. They didn't, okay? And look at all the interesting things, the medallions with all kinds of famous composers and names, and this is what it actually looks like. They didn't do any of it, okay? And so the little-known secret, or the very well-kept secret, or something that people don't talk about anyway, is the fact that nowhere on Symphony Hall does it say Symphony Hall carved into the building. Okay, there's a little centennial sign, you know, from 1976, whatever, but they never filled in any of those spaces, never wrote the Music Hall. Now, next time you go there, go to the marble staircases, and there are little medallions on the staircases, in the metal things, and they have BMH on them. Because it was supposed to be called the Boston Music Hall. Oh. Is that cool?
Yeah. Yes.
All right. It's cool. Okay. See, I told you you'd learn stuff. Okay. All right. Who are we? These guys over here? Okay, Trimounts. Near the intersection of Boylston and Tremont Streets, in an Emerson College building by the Lowe's Theater, is a 19th century structure decorated with bas-relief musical characters and names. The largest music publisher in America once called this building home. What? Oh, Frederica, just wait. What was his name?
His name was Oliver Ditson.
Yes. Nice. Okay, would you like to tell us anything? Okay.
Let's see what I remember. I believe he went into partnership with a gentleman named Mr. Hale, and then
I
later...
I think it was Haynes. Haynes.
Yep. I don't remember. And then he later bought him out and was in a somewhat of a partnership with someone else. And he was on Washington Street, I think, in at least one location, maybe two, before they moved to Tremont Street. And then they used to have a warehouse out on, Terrace Street in Roxbury, which is now housing. It was a big warehouse that's been converted to housing. And the six medallions on there have composers' names, and I know that because I used to stand there to take the bus, and one day I kept looking at it and I realized it had composers' names on it, but at that time, on the front of the building, it said Edison. And I kept thinking, why would the Edison Power Company have six composers' names on it? So that's why I went and looked it up.
Well, can I tell you something cool?
Yes.
Okay. So the Edison was because the Edison Electric Company was there for many years, starting, I think, in the 40s and 50s. And they didn't want to spend too much money on the sign, so they used the sun from Ditson and added the Edda there.
Oh, okay. Okie dokie.
So this is Oliver Ditson. Guys, if this were the 1880s, 90s, even into the 1920s, you would know this. And if you have old sheet music and go home, there's a really good chance it's going to say Oliver Ditson and Company. This guy was gigantic, gigantic. That's an image of him. He did all kinds of things. He did serious music. He did shabby parlor stuff. He did political stuff. Actually, people thought he did too much of the parlor songs and things like that, and some people made fun of him, but he made a whole lot of money. He did Fife books, too. Yeah. These are some of their catalogs inside the building that they had down there. Yeah. And this is what it looks like, 2 weeks ago. So if you go down to the Lowe's Theater, see where it says the Cord Building? Okay. And then you look up, you can go out, with your flashlights after the show. Mm-hmm. And so all along there, all kinds of musical icons left over. And that's the building now. And when he was there, she says, pushing, overshot. Okay, so there it is. So it really looks much the same. But they ended up selling all kinds of stuff. They were kind of like the Johnson String is Julie here? There's a representative from Johnson String if you want their successor to. it was an amazing thing, and he was an amazing person. There's some close, you can see Bizet and Wagner, and she's really, really trying, and some other close-ups there. So go down and see it. It's really, really cool. Okay. We ready, guys? Oh, that's his grave at Forest Hill Cemetery. This was actually made by Thomas Ball.
In Jamaica Plain.
In Jamaica Plain. You should read the book.
The fabulous.
Okay. All right. We ready, guys? Baroques? The original wooden hat shell opened on the Esplanade in 1929, thanks to a man who wanted both to bring music to the people and to provide BSO players with summer employment. What was this creative innovator's name?
The only way we get it is it.
It's Mr. Hatch.
I actually don't know.
It's Mr. Esplanade.
We have Mr. Hatch and Mr. Esplanade being discussed. You guys better start thinking we're in trouble here.
I don't either. Yeah, we need a lifeline.
You guys got to have to ask for it.
We need a lifeline.
Nobody has answered. Oh.
You can't use the same person twice.
Oh, they want to ask Frederica.
No, I don't think that works.
Okay, there's somebody. There's a gentleman in the back corner.
Okay, go back to him.
The honorable gentleman in the back corner.
I can see the hand rising above someone else.
Wait! What did you say, Hiller?
Fiedler.
Fiedler?
Fiedler.
Fiedler? Oh, well, you've got it anyway.
I told you that was a real brain.
There he is. Is that not a handsome man in 1929?
Oh, there's a footbridge.
And you thought he was a footbridge? And there he is. This was, there were, the hat shell you know today was built in 1940. This is his first one back in 1929. There were three really shabby incarnations before the current one was built. But there he is. And of course, he's very sophisticated there. You probably more remember him when he was, you know, with the Pops. Because this worked out so well, he was made the head of the Pops. It wasn't vice versa. This was 1929 when he had this idea. It was such a success that the next year they made him the conductor of the Pops. And so here he is in a more sophisticated setup, where much more recognizable. Okay, are we ready? We're on to the trimounts. In 1947, a Barbadian immigrant named Joseph L. Walcott opened a business in the South End that became an internationally known musical destination and an official historic landmark. What was the name of that business?
Doing it? Wally's Cafe?
You're saying Wally's Cafe? Yes! Excellent. Still, if how many people know about Wally's? If you haven't gone, you have to go. You just, you know, follow Symphony Hall and just keep on going on the right when you, just before you hit Columbus. It's an amazing place. It's been around since 47. Wally's no longer with us. He's buried at Forest Hill Cemetery. anyway, here are some of the scenes from the 40s of the hip dudes hanging inside and out. This was the place to go during the late 40s and the early 50s when there were still big bands going around, when Ellington and Ella and all those guys would come to town. They would do their big performances and then go over to Wally's. Also at that time, there were all kinds of other jazz and clubs in that area. It was a very hot area. But Wally's is still with us today. And even though the big bands aren't touring so much, they've got lots of famous people do come by, but also they cater to a lot of the students at Berkeley, NEC, whatever. You guys gotta go. It's a cool place. That's your friend.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, there you go. And this is a group, the jazz community, getting together to celebrate Wally's. Okay. So you're going. That's a destination. Okay, guys, you ready? Barokies?
Oh,
yep.
Yeah.
Oh.
Right.
Oh.
Get ready. Get ready.
So. The illustrious Ilsa is going to take over here, and this is the lightning round, and so I'm going to go over there, and you'll see what happens.
This probably wasn't a well thought out plan. Yeah. So we're going to raise our hands.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm very excited about this lightning round. As we were planning this, I thought we needed a lightning round with music. Why wouldn't we, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play a song, it's a clip of a song like we were talking about earlier, and then we're going to ask our panelists to identify the artist and the song. Each is worth 1 point, okay? So the way I'm going to structure this is if you know the artist but you don't know the song, I'm going to pass it to the next team, okay?
Well, that's not what she said.
Oh, you did? Okay.
If they got one of them, they could get a lifeline.
Okay. Okay, so we'll just do the lifeline thing. We'll just keep continuing with that. Sorry. It's okay. We'll just do it that way. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play about a 30 to 45 minute, 45 second clip. Let's not play 45 minutes. We'll be here all night. And then I'm going to try to give you a little bit of background on the song if you want me to do that. I feel like I have to follow up the act, Susan, you know, right? All right, so give me 1 second and I'm going to start the first clip. And I believe that the Broken Records are going first, is that right?
No, it's for anybody. Anybody can go.
Anybody on the team.
You're going to tell me.
On either team.
All right. Okay, that's good.
People in the front, help me see who's the first hand on either side.
Is that Microsoft sound?
Windows 9. Okay.
Who's going to draw?
Talking,
who
who's going to drive you home by the cars?
The artist is correct. The name of the song is not. It's close.
I guess we can get
Yep.
Who's going to drive me home tonight?
That is not correct.
Oh, I know what I mean.
We weren't ready.
Does anybody in the audience know the answer?
Playing it?
I know what.
We need a mic then. Who's going to take you home?
That is not correct.
Oh, can you play the rest
of it? Sure, let's play the rest of the answer. Or the. You're close, but that's not the name of the song. Roger knows the answer. Did you say you know the answer? Are you sure? The name of the song is Drive.
Oh, I'll
drive you home tonight.
What? I had drive. The
word. You did. Everybody had the word.
Okay, so nobody gets
it. It is just called Drive.
I know.
Okay. So that was a 1984 hit for the Cars, and it was basically written by Rick Ocasek, so, and produced by Mutt Lang, who was a famous producer. And they, if you don't know, are from Boston. All right?
Okay.
All right, here's number two.
Freeze Frame, J. Geil's Band.
That is correct.
Yeah.
2 points. Very nice. So if you didn't know, J. Geil's Band was made up of a bunch of Boston musicians. There's a very interesting character named Peter Wolf, who was their lead singer. He saw them at a venue in Boston and decided he was going to join that band. And they're still playing around town in different incarnations. If you've never seen Peter Wolf, look him up. Google him. Sure, it's the J. Geil's Band, and it's Freeze Frame is the name of the song. Yep. All right. You ready?
Yes, we're ready.
Are you ready?
Yes.
It's Aerosmith, and I need a lifeline for the name.
Come on.
Somebody in the audience must know the name. Thank you.
It is Walk This Way, so they get a point for that. But it is not Aerosmith.
Oh,
so I'm going to give you, turn it over to you guys.
So they get one. They don't get a point. They get one. You said they can't use the lifeline unless they had it right.
Run DMC.
That is correct. They did feature Aerosmith, and if any of you remember from the 80s, it is one of the greatest videos where basically Run DMC is standing there playing their beats, and Aerosmith is playing way too loud on the other side of the wall, and they kind of have this back and forth, and Aerosmith breaks through the wall, and then they collaborate, and they're on stage, and they're playing in their Adidas, and it's really great. So another Google. Okay.
Okay. That guitar lick is Aerosmith. That is not Run DMC.
That's true. It's
actually. Okay.
I don't want to argue, but.
Well, it wasn't Aerosmith. It was featuring Aerosmith. But they got one for the name of the song. Yep.
So it wasn't really Aerosmith.
Okay. Yeah. That's okay.
Come on, Jeff. Help me out.
It's only a point. Your point is good.
It's,
just,
it's about the pride, really. All right. Here is number four.
The band is Boston.
Yeah, it's Boston.
But I don't have the song title. I would like to do a lifeline for the song title.
Does anybody have a lifeline out there for her? No? Oh, somebody over in the corner.
Yes.
Say it again. That is correct. 2 points for these guys. I think my favorite part of that song is that they totally name drop in the first 30 seconds of the song, and they say, we're just another band out of Boston, and our name is Boston. Mm-hmm. So, nice. Nice job, guys. All right, here's number 5. Bobby, all right, do you have an answer?
Bobby Brown and My Prerogative?
That is correct.
Thanks, Carrie.
So Bobby Brown was in this band from Boston called New Edition. And New Edition kind of was a little upset when Bobby Brown decided to go out and do a solo career on his own. That song was kind of written in response to their indignation to the fact that he went on to do something else. So he, I believe, grew up in Dorchester, actually, and he's from Boston. So good old Bobby Brown. All right, we're going to move on to number 6. Susan, you're in charge.
So I think it's Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch. I'm embarrassed to say that. But I don't know the name of the song.
Do you want to use a lifeline?
Yes, please.
Yes, that yeah. Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch is correct.
That's horribly yes. embarrassing.
No, it's not. What are you talking about?
And that's why I was chosen to be a panelist. Does anybody know the name of that song? Yeah. Good Vibrations.
Good Vibrations is correct. 2 points all for right. these guys. See?
And that woman
See? Your 90s trivia paid off. So if you don't know Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch, Marky Mark is actually Mark Wahlberg, grew up in South Boston, and is now a big shot movie star. If you haven't seen that video, it's an interesting video. You should Google that. I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. These are all classic videos, so. But Marky Mark did grow up in Boston. All right, here we go. Number 7.
Dirty Water by the Standells.
That is correct. 2 points.
Yep. See, and I took it down.
Good.
I really thought I was going to have to play more than like 5 seconds of these. They're maybe not that one, but
they're from California.
And so, right. So they are not a Boston band. However, we all associate them with Boston because it's kind of the anthem of Boston somehow.
Not anymore.
That's right. So really, it's kind of a song that was written to make fun of Boston, but somehow we've all embraced it. So, all right, we're going to go on to number 8.
So they're going to kill us.
Gretchen, I think you got it.
Till Tuesday?
Yes.
That is correct.
And the name of the song is
Oh, can I have a lifeline from the other team? No?
If you want to give the point away, be my guest.
Hush, hush, voices downtown.
No, voices carry.
Voices carry. Voices carry.
Voices carry is correct. Very nice, guys. So Amy Mann is actually, she went to Berkeley, yeah. Yes, and she is a Boston. She was a, yeah. So she basically, they played around Boston for many years in the 80s, and that was kind of their big hit, was Voices Carry. All right, number 9. Yes.
Something to Talk About, Bonnie Raitt.
That is correct. 2 points.
Did she go to Berkeley?
Wow.
This is
This is going much better than I thought it was going to.
That's what we were thinking.
So Bonnie does have a connection to Boston, but I don't want to tell you what it is. So, no, we're going to wait. Just trust me. All right, last song. All right. Nice job, I'm impressed. This one's a little tougher. Ooh, Frederica.
Donna Summer and Bad Girls.
That is correct. Nice job. So Donna is also from the Dorchester area. Some people don't know that somehow, which I find surprising because she's just was amazing. She was the queen of disco. And basically that single was released in 1979 and it kind of became this icon that toot toot beep beep and you have something to add.
A piece of trivia for my personal career, when I was a fledgling piano teacher at the conservatory, I taught her sister Dara.
Really?
Yes.
That's
reluctant,
awesome.
Reluctant student and fledgling teacher. So, interesting experience.
Can I do autographs?
Yes.
Her brother lives in Oregon. Should I give you some wool for me?
Can you share that? Oh, it's
a rumor. But I think I read this, that
really?
She became a Christian later in her life and she refused to sing Bad Girls anymore. Yeah. This is a shame.
It's the baby, baby, the ooh baby song.
So the interesting story behind that was that the inspiration came to her when one of her assistants was stopped by the cops because she looked like a prostitute.
Uh-oh.
So she wrote the song and talked about that in the song, that, you know, looks aren't everything and whatnot. So it's an interesting song to play because I'm assuming that that may have or may not have happened in Boston. So
early profiling,
exactly. All right. Well, that worked really well. Thanks for letting me. Thanks for letting me play the mic. Thank you, contestants. Thank you, audience.
We're gonna put my computer back on. Okay. Do you know how to do that?
What?
Put my computer back on.
Stand up.
You just gonna.
Okay. Let's move this show.
Oh, that was the last one.
We're done playing around with you guys now.
Okay.
Yeah. It's.
But it's.
Yeah. It does that.
Now,
who?
Huh? I think it's easier.
It's
ours.
It's okay. Oh, there's all your answers.
There's all my answers.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
We went a different route.
Those would have helped.
We weren't going to see them.
All right.
See, it says Aerosmith.
You missed it.
Featuring Aerosmith. Featuring Aerosmith. I'm sorry we're having such trouble with this. Okay, now we're getting back to the antiquated esoteric questions. And does anyone remember who was on last?
Oh, they were on last.
I think it's our.
It was your turn? Okay, so we're going to be going on to the Baroques. If we can just get this dang thing to work. Okay, here we go. Baroques, you ready? Okay, that's okay. Here we go. Could the house lights come down even a little more? Is there a chance to do that so we can see this better? During the 1951 pre-Broadway tryouts of The King and I at Boston's Schubert Theater, Rodgers and Hammerstein needed another song for the limited vocal range of star Gertrude Lawrence. They found a discarded love song they'd penned for South Pacific and wrote new lyrics to fit the tale of Anna and the King of Siam. What was the name of that now classic song?
My degree, my license. That's a pretty long name. I don't know if it's right though. Maybe we should just go.
Okay, guys, I'm going to have to ask you for an answer or a lifeline.
Do you want to just say?
Yeah, we
want to
go for a lifeline.
Could you put that in the mic?
We have a clue, but we need a lifeline.
Just
a lifeline. Anyone you want.
Getting to know you.
You're saying it was getting to know you?
Lifeline.
Could you say that into the mic?
Getting to know you?
Been practicing for days for this. Days. Well, I just tell it like I read it. Anyway, so that was the song added while they were in Boston. As you remember, we used to be the tryout town, and while they were here, they said, man, we're in trouble. What are we going to do? They came up with this song. Gertrude Lawrence sang it. It became her signature. By the way, just to show you how imagery changed, that was Gertrude with Yul Brynner, who we remember looking quite different because we remember him in the movie with whom?
Mary.
Deborah Carr, right. And so, but this was the Broadway production, and that's Rodgers, Hammerstein. Anyone know who's between them?
Irving Berlin.
Irving Berlin, very good.
That's 2 points.
Okay, and then this is now Yul Brynner gets to be one of the more famous people, and there they are with an image that you recognize much more from the movie version. By the way, does anyone know anything about the vocals done by Deborah Carr in the movie?
Oh, they were something else.
Yes? Oh, bring a mic over there. Because we had problems with vocals with Deborah Carr.
Was it Marnie Nixon?
You betcha. Okay. The woman who sang for everybody, Marnie.
For Audrey Hepburn.
Yeah. Whenever, and doesn't she look like, who does she look like?
Julie Andrews.
She looks like Julie Andrews, yeah. Marnie Nixon was the voiceover for everybody. She did it for Audrey Hepburn in My Fair Lady, because Audrey couldn't sing. She sang for Deborah Carr. She sang for everybody, filled in all the gaps. The only person she didn't sing for was Julie Andrews, who happened to be one of these people who could sing. Yes. Catherine.
And I believe her name never appeared on the credits, is that?
No, correct? But she made a good living.
Yeah.
Whatever. Okay, but that all happened in Boston. Getting to know you happened in Boston. Okay, you guys? The song called MTA chronicled the woes of a man named Charlie who needed one more nickel to get off the Boston subway train. What was the name of the man for whom the song was written?
We need a lifeline. We know, but we need a confirmation.
Okay, you guys choose. Whoever looks the most adamant.
Lady right there.
George O'Brien.
I'm sorry.
Walter.
Fight the fair increase, vote for George O'Brien. That's the way it was in the song, but that wasn't his name.
And it was for Walter O'Brien.
Walter A. O'Brien.
Walter A. O'Brien. Yes. Charlie, since you know the answer, could you explain why in the song it says, fight the fair increase, vote for George O'Brien, but his real name was Walter O'Brien?
Because Walter O'Brien was a leftist, and
he was a commie pinko.
The song was first recorded commercially about 8 years later. It got banned, and so when the Kingston Trio took it a couple of years after that, they changed the name so it would be not objectionable to the Red Scare people.
Progressive means he believed like in integrated schools, you know, just nutty stuff. Things to be affordable for poor people, to, you know, just crazy, insane lefto pinky things. And there's from, because that song became so popular, bringing him a sandwich. This is Walter O'Brien, who I had the opportunity to interview in the late 90s, living up in Maine. And when we were there, I was able to meet also with Jacqueline Steiner, who was a college girl at the time, and she, along with Bess Lomax Hawes, wrote the song for his campaign. So that's the two of them together holding one of those old vinyl records. They went to the recording studio to do this. I believe it cost them $20.
You realize the subtext of that song, don't you? I mean, it begs the larger question, why she could make a sandwich but not pack a nickel.
Right. Because then you
have... It's a state of their marital bliss, I'm sure.
You're right, David.
Sure.
And there's the Kingston Trio who made a mint off that nickel. Okay. We're on to... Who are we on to?
Barokes.
You guys? Oh, we're the Brokes? Okay, the Brokes. Here we go. With the recent passing of Phil Everly, we are reminded that in 1957, a hit tune by the Everly Brothers was banned in Boston because of its immoral undercurrent. What was the name of that tune?
Wake Up Little Susie.
You say Wake Up Little Susie?
Yes.
Dan?
Yeah, really.
I told you he'd been working hard on this all week. Would anyone like to tell us why in lovely Boston we thought Wake Up Little Susie was an immoral song?
Because they fell asleep.
Well, who knows what they've been doing when they were night, when they were woke up in the morning.
Where were they?
Not at home. They were in a movie theater.
Right. And then what happened?
And then they fell asleep during the movie.
And then what happened?
And they stayed in there all night.
And then what happened?
Well, we don't know. What they were in trouble deep.
They were in trouble deep. The movie's over, it's 4 o'clock, and we're in trouble deep. Okay. All right, so yes, that was banned in Boston. It was a major hit for the Everly Brothers. It was actually their second big single. Okay, we're moving on to you guys. You ready? Oh, by the way, there it is. This couple, husband and wife couple, wrote many of the tunes that the Everly Brothers sang, actually. And there's the single. Their single, and there are the brothers with swell hair. Okay, here we go. Trimounts. During the late 1960s and early 70s, the world's finest rock and blues bands played the Fillmore West in San Francisco. What was that venue's Boston counterpart, a local club that hosted concerts by everyone from Jethro Tull, The Who, Led Zeppelin, and the Rolling Stones, to Canned Heat, The Velvet Underground, and Elton John? There's a good lifeline back there if you guys need one. Wait, they didn't ask you yet.
We're going to go with the paradise. Uh-oh. I just wanted to hear that lovely tune.
It was the Boston Tea Party.
It was the Boston Tea Party. Yeah, I can just hear Canned Heat playing that. Yep. Mr. Krim, did you want to add any stories about the Boston Tea Party? Did you take drugs there? Could someone bring a microphone over there?
Yeah, really. Right behind you.
So it was Don Law's first job running a rock venue. And he went on from the Boston Tea Party, but that's where he started.
And wasn't Don Lawrence in college at the time when he was doing that?
Okay.
All right. The Boston Tea Party, only
Thank you.
2 centuries. I think the Globe said 1 century apart from the Tea Party here. And indeed, it was 2 centuries apart. Okay, so anyway, here's some of the albums and posters and stuff like this. This was the place to be in the late 60s and early 70s in Boston. And it was actually, it started out on Berkeley Street in an old Unitarian church that later became an underground theater place, and then moved later over to Lansdowne. And there's Don Law in the upper right, and the Bostonian Society plaque talking about this famous rock and roll club. Okay, who's on next?
Oh, they are.
You guys? Okay.
If we do want to point out that the Tea Party moved, it was in that venue, but then they relocated to Lansdowne.
Yeah, I think I said that. Yeah. They relocated to Lansdowne. Didn't I say that?
Oh.
See? Oh, there's someone wants to add a story. Do we have a microphone?
One second. The Lost Hurrah. The bar was.
Wait.
What is she doing?
No, it's
well,
your...
Well, but she just answered the question.
No.
Okay, you're right. Okay, well, we're going to move on. Okay, the question was, between 1977 and 91, the Whitaker family was credited with bringing back big band swing music to Boston and to the nation. At which local bar were they the resident band during those 14 years? The Last Hurrah. Okay, let's move on.
Still in.
Okay, and there's the Whitakers. we'll have another question for you guys. Okay, and there they are, and I'm really trying to show you other images. There's Bo Whitaker playing there. And there's their mom, Annette, who was the bass player. And here are the guys this is in the new Last Hurrah. I took this picture a few months ago, and this is in my new book. Yes, it was in the basement of the Omni Parker House. Right. It was on the basement level. If you go in there now, there's the gym, or there's a gym and general offices. And then today, the Last Hurrah upstairs wouldn't have room for a band, but this is these guys. And as I was saying, they're in my new book about the Omni Parker House, Heaven by Hotel Standards, she plugs. Okay. All right, guys, you ready here? Is it you?
Yeah.
That was our question.
Oh, so you get it, okay. In 1970, an off-Broadway musical by Langston Hughes, originally called Wasn't It a Mighty Day, made its Boston debut at Tremont Temple. By what name is this annual performance best known?
Shall we go for it?
I guess we'll go for it.
They're not sure, but they think they have it.
The Black Nativity?
It is the Black Nativity! Really good, Dan. Anyway, scenes from the Black Nativity, which exist to this day, for decades it was at around the corner at Tremont Temple, but now they do it over at Northeastern. And there's Langston Hughes, who wrote it, and there's Elma Lewis and Cassius Clay at the Parker House. And Elma Lewis was behind this for many years, the doyenne of arts. And in Roxbury and surrounding areas, and Cassius Clay, I don't know, kissing her. Okay. All right, guys, you ready? This is Tremont's. In 1991, when the ultra-conservative NEA decided to pull funding for the Boston showing of an exhibit by photographer Robert Mapplethorpe, what Boston-based musicians saved the day?
We're unanimous in our answer.
We'd like a lifeline. Someone, please.
Carrie just says, it's not Kusevitsky.
Which was going to be her answer for every question.
She was going to answer that to everything
but
until
this
it
one.
Was.
Yeah. No one's going to help us here. No one's going to help us.
Okay, so this
This is a sad day in Boston.
Under George W. Bush, the NEA got an ultra-conservative director, and they decided they did not want Mapplethorpe's body parts, I'm trying to give hints so someone will think of it, to let it show at MIT, and they pulled the plug, and people in Boston got upset, because we were beyond the banned in Boston time. And this one local group said, we're going to give you $10,000, and you can do it.
Is that something that I should know?
Yeah.
They might be giants?
No.
No. I lost track of where we are.
Yeah, so they get it.
Do you guys get to do it?
You said that in 9 years you'd never had a question that no one could answer?
Yeah, I did say that.
Okay, one second.
We get 5 points for that, don't we? For being the first and...
Hey. I kind of was giving you hints.
Could have been something.
Genre?
It's a rock genre whose name has already been mentioned.
Yeah, I think... Oh, Boston.
There it is.
I was...
Okay, what do we do? Yes, it's Aerosmith. Yes, it's Aerosmith.
Let's just call it.
You're giving hints.
Yeah, just we're going to call it. We're going to call it.
I think you've broken your record now. You have a question that's not been answered.
Well, she got
okay. Anyway, it was Aerosmith. There they are. They did indeed come up with $10,000. We had the exhibit. Among the other people in town who complained, Beacon Press had an NEA grant for them to make a book, and Wendy Strothman, who was the head of Beacon Press at the time, said, no, we're not going to accept it. So many people just turned down NEA grants because they were so irate at the intense conservatism. There's Mapplethorpe there. Okay. And this is one of the articles in the Village Voice mentioning both Beacon Press and Aerosmith, who saved the day for the exhibit and for the freedom of art. Okay. It's you guys now. Okay. This Cambridge resident, once a child prodigy who performed for Presidents Eisenhower and Kennedy, was educated at Juilliard and Harvard. Her primary instrument was built by Domenico Montagnana. I'm sorry, in 1733, and is nicknamed Petunia. What is the musician's name?
Let's just think about it before we jump into it.
I know.
Because there are more positive.
Yeah.
Okay. Foster?
It is.
Yo. Yo-yo.
Ma! Yes!
Well, that's the part it didn't
know. Raise your hand if you knew that.
No.
Okay. He was once playing out in Salt Lake City, and a young girl in his class, in one of his classes, asked if his cello had a name, and he said, "No, but I'll play you a tune if you name it." And she named it Petunia, and it's been named Petunia ever since. There you go. Okay, guys, you ready over there?
Yep.
Ooh. Okay. You ready, audience?
It's theirs, right?
Audience, okay, so you're playing for this team over there, and they will either accept or reject what you say. Fie or huzzah. Whenever the Red Sox win a home game, the strains of Neil Diamond's classic Tessie blast over the sound system at Fenway Park. Those who think it's true, huzzah! Hey, shh! No, please don't go out. Okay. How many people think yes? Huzzah. Oh my goodness. How many people think fie? Whoa.
Well, this is a tough one.
What do you think, guys?
We better think about this.
Are you accepting that?
Yes.
Okay. Do you guys know anything further about the true answer here?
Yes. Is it Dropkick Murphys?
Dropkick Murphys?
Dropkick Murphys.
Could you say that?
Dropkick Murphys.
It's by the Dropkick Murphys, okay? So indeed, that is their tune. That is what you play after a win. There they are. There's Fenway Park, and not to be confused with Neil Diamond's "Sweet Caroline," which is already sung there. Okay, you're good, guys. Okay, you ready, guys, Barokers?
Oh yeah.
Okay, here we go.
See, that's why you're not.
Gretchen is not a happy camper. What does the educational tour group Boston by Foot have in common with the rock band They Might Be Giants?
The last name Flansburg, as in Polly, the founder of Boston by Foot, and I forget her son's name from the group.
I'm sorry, Gretchen, who is a Boston by Foot tour guide? How many Boston by Foot tour guides do we have here? How many of you knew that answer? Yeah, everybody. Yeah, okay. Anyway, there's Polly and John, and there they are at a cocktail party doing something. She asked me to Photoshop out the glasses. I was just going to put skulls. Well, anyway. So here is Boston by Foot tour going on. Been around since the centennial, is that correct? 1976?
1976.
They Might Be Giants has been around since 82, I think. I think it was that. Yeah, they were, actually John met his partner that he plays in They Might Be Giants with when they were both at Pratt at art school. And there's, these guys are lunatics and they're wonderfully talented. But there's John playing. Okay. All right. Whose turn? Over here? Okay. Among the many heartfelt battles being waged by Boston Mayor Marty Walsh's chief of policy, Joyce Linehan, is trying to get what official designation for Jonathan Richman's song, Roadrunner? It's their turn?
Yeah.
Do you guys know, or do you need a lifeline?
No, the state rock song?
The state rock song! Yes!
Every state needs one, right?
And it is indeed true. This is Jonathan Richman's, nobody has been able to pin down for sure exactly when it came out, because they were singing it and playing it and making singles and doing different versions, but it did come out in the 70s. And there's Roadrunner, and yes, Joyce is, does anyone know where she is in that battle to get that, the official state rock song? No, okay. Just so you know the obscurity of this, does anyone know any of the state songs? Yeah, who knows? Who knows that stuff, okay? We have, I had to, Mary had a little lamb, it should be. No, our state anthem is All Hail to Massachusetts by Arthur Marsh. Our state folk song is Massachusetts by Arlo Guthrie. Did you know that?
We have a polka.
Our state ceremonial march, The Road to Boston. We have state glee, and we have a state polka song.
Yes.
Why do we have that? Which is Say Hello to Someone from Massachusetts by Lenny Gamulka.
Why not?
Okie dokie.
Why not?
All right.
Can we have the Fifer play the polka song, please?
Yeah.
Yes. Can you do a polka, Dan?
No, he's got to play the official.
Oh, the official state polka? Fake it.
I'm sorry.
Fake it. Oh, you're too honest. Okay. All right, guys, we are now at our final round. Oh, there's Joyce Linehan, who used to work with rock and roll bands. Needless to say, now is the second in command. Really, really, you know she is, with Marty Walsh. Here we go. Okay, this is the round. You guys be quiet, okay? All right. Can we have one other person to help for the first hand up? Janine, can you do that? Okay, so this is going to be just like the other one. And Ilse, if you just want to score, Carrie, keep your hand down. Okay. I'm going to show you a picture. There's a girl, a college girl, okay? I can say girl because it's okay. We're post-feminist world. Okay, you're going to see a person. You get 1 point for the name of the woman who became a famous musician, second for the school she went to. Like the other, if you get one and need a lifeline for the other, you can. Okay? This is first hand first. Here we go.
I'm really... I think it was Kerry.
Don't buy it, Boston University.
Yes!
It's like my mother.
Okay, indeed, Joan Baez was kicked out of BU. Okay, all right. It's all right, but she went there. Okay, are you ready? I believe it was Catherine.
Tracy Chapman Tufts.
Yes! Can you believe that's Tracy Chapman? And I know that was 1984 because I took that picture, yeah. She didn't have any money, so she painted my studio walls in return. Okay, ready?
Yeah.
Oh. Frederica.
Esperanza Spalding, yes. Berkeley.
Esperanza Spalding, Berkeley. The woman who knocked out Justin Bieber in Best New Artist at the Grammys. Was it 2 years ago?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, indeed. Okay. And you're giving 2 points for each. Right, okay. I think it was Frederica. Okay.
Bonnie Raitt, Lifeline. Lifeline.
School. Bonnie Raitt School. Somebody?
No.
No, I'm...
Hold on.
He said Harvard, but it's not right.
We have...
But she was pointing to someone else. Who did you point to?
Right. Can you give her a microphone? Radcliffe, did everybody hear that?
Radcliffe, yes, indeed. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Okay, Bonnie Raitt, Radcliffe. Excellent. You ready? Kerry.
Denise Graves, New England Conservatory.
Denise Graves, New England Conservatory. Woo! Okay.
Oh.
Kerry.
Jojo, what's her name?
Oh, God, my word.
Jojo.
Kerry?
I can't believe this.
Do you want to call a lifeline?
No!
You've got to get one of them first.
I don't want to call a lifeline. This is ridiculous. It just escaped me. No, we can't. They have to get...
I'm sorry, what'd you say? Diana Krall?
Berkeley.
Berkeley! Yes! Nice. Okay, ready?
Oh.
Frederica.
Coretta Scott King, New England Conservatory.
Coretta Scott, who became Coretta Scott King at the New England Conservatory. That's it, guys. We just finished. That was great. And the totals, what are the actual numbers? I can't count that well.
More to less.
27 for the Trimont tones and
44. Oh! Okay. But again, a round of applause. You guys were great. You guys were great. What a great evening. Thank you so much, and we'll see you again next year.